everything I know I've learned from you. You've always been there to see me through. There's a feeling we share, a feeling we hold on to. Can't beat it, you know it's the real thing. The feeling you get when you know there's someone there for you. Can't beat the real thing. Coca-Cola Classic.
Thanks, Dad.
Messenger, Mercury. He rides the wind above us all. Some say his gifts are from God. Others say he's just a man. A man who has soared above and beyond all who have come to play this game.
Backhand to the blue line, take away. Gretzky in front alone. He deeps, he shoots, he scores. Gretzky jumps up down a little. Gretzky in front, shoots, score!
Legend springs up in the simplest places. Wayne Gretzky learned to skate on his grandparents' farm, hard by the Nith River, just outside the small Canadian town of Brantford, Ontario. The farm and his family were his foundation. His passion, even at 2½, was hockey.
Well, the first time Wayne skated was on the river at my mother's. He had the right idea because he had been skating, but without skates, in the living room at my mom's out the farm. It was a pine wood floor, and he would just slide across the floor back and forth, and he had a little hockey stick with a ball, and she was basically, to say, his first goaltender, and he banged her shins a few times with that stick.
Wayne Gretzky may have been the first four-year-old to have his own backyard rink.
Many people think I made it to make him a hockey player, but I'll tell you honestly, it was self-survival, because they'd take him over to the park and he wouldn't want to come home and I'd be freezing to death.
I would skate for 7 or 8 hours a day. People would say, boy, you know, how could you practice that much? And I think, looking back at it, if I would have considered it practice, I probably wouldn't have done it. I considered it fun, and that was my enjoyment in life. I would usually skate from about, you know, 7 to 8:30, and come in, go to school, come home at lunch, and then I'd be on the ice from 3:30 till my mom would make me come in for dinner, and then I'd have dinner and rest for a few minutes and go back out. And you know, it was religious for me. I never missed. It was like that was my enjoyment in life.
He excelled in baseball, lacrosse, and track and field, but he was consumed by hockey. He watched the NHL on hockey night in Canada religiously every Saturday night out at the farm.
I've seen him when he was a little kid have his hockey equipment on in the middle of the summer. It'd be 95 out. And he'd be roasting, but he'd be running around there with a ball and a hockey stick.
At 5, he could stick handle better than most 12-year-olds. At 8, he was scoring almost at will. At 9, he became a national curiosity. Not yet 10, Gretzky had scored his 1,000th goal.
We were in last place in our division, and I wondered why the Brockville Arena was filled to capacity. We had just finished playing or getting close to the end of the game, and halfway through our game, the arena filled up. And I was wondering what all this magic was about. And all of a sudden, the Brantford Hockey Club came on the ice, and it was Wayne Gretzky, a person with white gloves on. I had never seen the boy play. And that particular day, he played left wing, he played right wing, he played center, left defense, right defense. He played every position but goal. And if my memory serves me correctly, he got 4 or 5 goals that day.
He so loved the game that he often played in 2 leagues. On one occasion, he helped win an out-of-town game, then was rushed to help save another just hours later.
We were losing 5-1, 6-1, I guess it was. And all of a sudden, I got a tap on the shoulders that Wayne was on his way. Well, that went through the arena like, you know, wildfire. Wayne's on his way, Wayne's on his way is all you could hear. So, of course, I said, you know, my other players, I said, you know, just all you have to do is hold him. I said, you know, Wayne's coming, Wayne's coming, type thing. So that was that part of it. Wayne got there. When the game ended up, it was 6-5 for Brantford. We had won the game.
It was a time like never before in Canadian hockey. A 10-year-old boy was selling out 16,000-seat arenas. He was a bubblegum wizard, scoring a staggering 378 goals in one season.
He wouldn't go around saying, well, I'm the best, I'm going to be the best. But he always just wanted to be the best. He always loved to win. Of course, everyone in our family, the kids, they can't even play cards without fighting because they all want to win.
So good was the kid from Brantford that he earned a moment with the reigning king of hockey, Gordie Howe. As it is in many small towns, fame is often followed by resentment. He had become more famous than the town's most historic figure, Alexander Graham Bell.
I became a little bit of a small celebrity in a small town where I excelled in sports. And what happened was there became no in-between for people. Either they loved me and they treated me with, carpets, a red carpet treatment, that sort of thing, or they hated me, or they're envious or disliked me. There was never anybody that really treated me as, quote, Wayne Gretzky the student or Wayne Gretzky the athlete.
At 14, the pressure of performing in Brantford became too great for the young sensation. The Gretzkys challenged the Canadian amateur hockey laws for the right for the young star to play elsewhere. The Gretzkys won, and the teenager moved in with family friends in nearby Toronto. Wayne Gretzky simply wanted to become lost in the crowd. The brilliance of his play, even as a 14-year-old playing Junior B hockey, was simply too glaring to miss. He was then drafted into Junior A by the Sault Ste. Marie Greyhounds. Now at 16, the high school freshman would be playing against bearded and burly 200-pound men. He again would be Rookie of the Year. Already wearing his trademark number 99, his extraordinary play earned him an invitation to represent Canada in the World Junior Championships.
All along, I expected not to make it because I was so young. I made the team. You know, I ended up having a very solid tournament, and I made first team All-Star center. And I remember sitting in Montreal, sitting with my parents, saying, you know, I just played with the three guys that are going to be the first three picks in the NHL next year. And I felt that I played as well as they did against the best competition in the world. And if they can play professionally, I remember saying that I can.
Nelson Skelbania, the maverick owner of the World Hockey Association's Indianapolis Racers, agreed. Skelbania signed 17-year-old Wayne Gretzky to a whopping contract. Still, there were those who predicted his downfall. Rumored to be in a financial squeeze, Skelbania liquidated his prime hockey asset, selling Wayne Gretzky to Edmonton of the WHA. And so, the little kid who had practiced into the night began what would be a storybook career with the Edmonton Oilers. If pro football had its Green Bay, then pro hockey was to have its Edmonton. This golden farmland would become the unlikely backdrop for one of hockey's most impossible dynasties. Mature beyond his years, the adored young millionaire Gretzky would lead this historic charge with the values he was taught on the farm. Not yet 18 years old, Wayne Gretzky again proved the skeptics wrong. Number 99 made the WHA All-Star team and realized his dream of playing with his boyhood hero, Gordie Howe. As legends so often go, the Gretzky-Howes trio overwhelmed their opponents from the opening faceoff. His critics again shook their heads as he finished his first pro year with 104 points and was voted WHA Rookie of the Year. Not yet 6 feet and only 170 pounds, Wayne returned to the farm and his family for his escape.
It was a place where we would go and kind of forget about everything.
Meanwhile, the WHA was failing. The Edmonton Oilers, chock full of good young talent, were quickly absorbed into the NHL. The great Gretzky at 18 would now appear on Hockey Night in Canada in the National Hockey League.
I can remember my grandmother, 78 years old, has gone to every game that we've had in the last 11 years, and the first year, halfway through the first year, and she was saying, well, you guys are going to win a Stanley Cup because Wayne's on your team. And at that moment, I think everybody kind of knew that there was something special going on.
Something special was going on. The teenager, who was supposed to be swallowed up by whiskered monsters in the NHL, tied Marcel Dion for the scoring lead with 137 points, the biggest season ever for a rookie. He was voted the National Hockey League's most valuable player, another first for a rookie. Despite a marvelous first year by Gretzky, the Oilers had a rough initiation into the senior league.
If you followed that team in 79-80, you would have shook your head. But by 81-82, you would have said, this team's going to win the Stanley Cup, no question.
For those who still questioned his skill and durability, his second season in the NHL removed all doubts. The 1980-81 season saw him dish off a record 109 assists, shattering the legendary Bobby Orr's mark of 102. He won his second straight league MVP award. And finally, the hockey world could see but one name on the trophy for the NHL scoring champion, his. More importantly, he led the youngest team in the NHL to an astounding sweep of the famed Montreal Canadiens in the first round of the playoffs. It was a signal of what was to come. The 80-81 season also brought the perfect complement to number 99's breathtaking passing game. A 20-year-old Finn named Jari Kurri.
Jari and I played at instinct. He knew me and I knew him like we were one. And as well as I passed the puck, he had the ability to get in the open. I mean, that's how good he was.
Though the Canadian and the Finn at first could barely understand each other, they both spoke fluent offense. The greatest passer in the world teamed up with one of the finest pure shooters in the game. The results were explosive.
Curry back to Gretzky, to Curry scores! Here's Gretzky moving in with Curry across, to Curry scores! And it's 3-2! To Gretzky, back to Yari, Curry shoots, scores! And it's fine!
Perhaps more than any season thus far, 1981-82 may have marked Wayne Gretzky forever as the great one. With Curry and the Oilers at his side, number 99 began taking apart the pyramids of hockey stone by stone. Only two players had ever scored 50 goals in 50 games. It was considered the benchmark of all great scorers. After only 38 games, he needed just 5 goals to reach the record 50. While the hockey world anticipated him breaking this record, nobody could have predicted the night of December 30th, 1981, against Philadelphia, his 39th game.
Gretzky with the puck in front, Gretzky scores!
He's got it to Gretzky, he's got the open net, Gretzky, will he shoot? He does! He scores! Wayne Gretzky's 50th goal! He has broken the record! His 50th goal in 39 games! Gretzky has done the unbelievable! 5 goals tonight! They are going wild!
Going to the rink that day is really funny feeling for whatever reason, because I never get a feeling like that. And, bang, I had 3 goals or like that, and I was thinking on the ice, well, my dad's going to be upset he's not here. So even when I scored the 5th goal, I was thinking, it's too bad they weren't here. And when I went in, it was, first thing I did was I called them to see if they were singing, because I know my dad likes to be at everything that I do, or even any of his kids do. So I kind of felt bad that he wasn't there, so I picked up the phone and phoned him.
During that little conversation, as a father, it was the most rewarding thing that ever has happened to me, I think, in regards to Wayne. All his honors and everything else, because you try to visualize or even think about yourself possibly in that situation. Would you automatically remember to call your mom and dad, excuse yourself from all the news media, and I'm sure it must have been awfully hectic. And he just called, and he was on the phone about 10 seconds, and he says, well, I gotta go, they're waiting for me. And that was it.
The joy of his accomplishments had spilled over into his hometown of Brantford. He was proclaimed at 19 the game's greatest player. He was being compared to Babe Ruth, Jack Nicklaus, and Larry Bird. Wayne still remembers his father's words when, as a 6-year-old, he cried at not receiving a trophy for his play on a 10-year-old team.
Don't be disappointed that you didn't get a trophy. He said, one day we won't have room for all your trophies. And I mean, I'm sure a lot of parents say that to cheer up their kids, but it was kind of funny. I always remember that, and now, there isn't really room.
Through it all, he believed in giving something back. For over a decade, he has hosted a celebrity sports classic for the blind. The event has attracted some of Hollywood's most famous residents. But then, Wayne Gretzky has attracted some attention himself.
Wayne Gretzky for Pro Stars. What do your kids get when they take up the challenge of Wayne Gretzky's rocket hockey?
Cannon makes it simple to handle any shot.
Mom likes them too because there's no sugar added. Right, Mom?
That's right, Wayne.
And you like Pro Stars because your picture's on the box, right?
Where Gillette products are sold, it's the place to be. Unless you've got a game.
Enter while you can.
Back on the ice, the great one's dominance continued. In only his third NHL season, he demolished 2 records most thought would stand for decades. He first broke Phil Esposito's mark of 152 points in a season. Then, in the same month, he took dead aim on Espo's record of 76 goals in a single season.
Back to Patrick Gretzky, took it away from him. Gretzky moving in. The shot, he scores! Gretzky, 77th of the year. The miracle has ended. Gretzky has pulverized another National Hockey League record.
If that was not enough for 1 year, he proceeded to become the first player to break the 200-point barrier in 1 year. His 212 points and 92 goals left hockey historians scratching their heads.
Like everyone else, I didn't realize that I was living with and playing with soon to be the best hockey player in the history of the game and perhaps one of the best athletes in the history of civilization, if you want to go back that far. I mean, that's to the extreme of his accomplishments.
The 20-year-old was making miracles mundane. In his next season, Gretzky won his third straight scoring title and his fourth consecutive league MVP trophy. But it was his performance in the 83 NHL All-Star game that left fans with their jaws on the floor.
Gretzky, his second goal of the period. Wilson in deep center, Gretzky, he scores! That's a hat trick for Wayne Gretzky. Here comes Gretzky again with Curry.
Wayne Gretzky had scored 4 goals in 1 period against the best players in the game. But what he really wanted was the Stanley Cup. Later that year, in the Cup Finals, it was not to be. The peach-fuzzed Oilers lost to the three-time Cup champion New York Islanders in 4 straight games. He remembers the moments after the loss.
Kevin and I saying, well, they're going to be celebrating. Let's get going, get past there, and get on the bus. And as we walked, got closer and closer, it was pretty quiet. We didn't think anybody was in their room. And as we kind of looked in, the people who were celebrating were management, family, wives, that sort of thing. The players themselves were so exhausted, so tired. Ice packs, you know, that sort of thing. Sitting there, it was kind of like, you know, it's over, and here we are, we were fine. We were like, no problems at all. And we got on the bus, and I remember Kevin saying, that's the difference, that they won and they're wounded, we lost and we're fine.
It was a message the Oiler captain would not forget. Gretzky attacked the 83-84 season with a vengeance. He was driven to bring a Stanley Cup to Edmonton. He was a blur, a goal-scoring, puck-spinning dervish. He started a streak by scoring in the first 43 games of the year, but in game 44, it looked as though the Chicago Blackhawks had stopped him cold. He scored his final point of this historic streak in his 51st consecutive game. The record had been 28. To hockey historians, it was unfathomable. Again, the Oilers earned the right to face a dynasty in the Cup Finals, the four-time Cup champion New York Islanders. But times change, and so does history. Somewhere, a grandmother grinned. A blonde-haired kid from Brantford had led this team from the plains of northern Canada to NHL history. They would become the greatest offensive machine in hockey history. The following season, the word dynasty surfaced again, this time referring to the Edmonton Oilers, as they crushed the Philadelphia Flyers in 5 games for their second straight cup. Yeah! Gretzky was at his very best in this series, scoring a staggering 47 points in only 18 games. Totals not equaled by some entire teams. Again, he was awarded both the regular season and playoff MVP trophies. For a man who had come to make the impossible happen daily, it seemed that Gretzky would now have a hard time topping himself, but he did. In his next season, 1986, he accomplished the unthinkable. On his way to a seventh straight MVP award, he won his sixth straight scoring title on his assists alone. It was like winning the Major League Baseball batting title, hitting 700. That same year, the Oilers beat Philadelphia in a tough seven-game cup final series for their third Stanley Cup. Once again, the Great One led the playoffs in scoring. But Gretzky, the scoring machine and hockey ambassador, was a different breed. The farther his talents took him, the more he thought about where it had all begun.
You know, everybody talks about how my dad made me a hockey player and what, you know, how my dad put me in the NHL, but you know, the sacrifices my mother made, not going out on Friday night because, you know, we're gonna use the money to buy me a pair of skates, or you know, not buying new curtains because I needed new hockey sticks. Things like that, you know, a lot of parents just don't do.
The following year brought yet another Stanley Cup. The Oilers defeated the Boston Bruins for the team's fourth cup in 5 years. In July, following the victory, Wayne celebrated a most cherished moment in his life when he married the beautiful actress, Janet Jones, in a fairy tale wedding.
I remember being very nervous right before I turned to the door, more so because of all the happening, everything going on in the church and everything. But I knew I was so right, and Wayne and I were so right together, that I was not nervous about that. And when I turned around, and I saw him standing there, and he looked so great, and I just knew he was the right man, and I was just walking down there. It was just the best feeling.
Maybe one of the most stunning moments in my life, when I look back and I saw her. She looked incredible. I guess the words can't describe how she looked. But more than that, I just knew that I was marrying a great lady.
But even before the wedding, while celebrating on the ice after defeating Boston for their fourth cup, Wayne sensed that something was about to happen.
Just as everybody's kind of ready to leave the ice, you know, it's like, I don't know, it's like a flash or whatever. And I got everybody to stay on the ice, and I got this picture of everybody on the ice with the Stanley Cup, from the trainers to the players to the scouts to the players who weren't dressed that night. And there we were on the ice. I think that moment might have been kind of topped off everything that I ever did as an Oiler. You know, nobody would at that point in time ever know. I didn't even know that that'd be my last picture or great moment as an Oiler.
August 9th, 1988. It was the biggest deal in the history of professional sports. The $15 million sale emotionally ravaged the heartland of Canada. The Canadian government was asked to intervene.
It built up over a period of time. The relationship deteriorated. in Edmonton with management.
Edmonton fans had lost their favorite son.
I was with my mom, who's the biggest Wayne and Gretzky fan that ever lived, and she started crying.
It's still tough to go to Coliseum and think that Gretzky's not going to be there.
I was having breakfast, and then I cried. For 3 days, I cried.
Oh, every time I see him on TV, on a Coke commercial or something, your heart just goes.
I just couldn't believe it, really, why they would trade him.
He should still be here in Edmonton.
His teammates were left devastated by the deal.
My agent called that and there was a rumor that Wayne could be a soul. I say, come on, that could never happen. And two hours later, he called me, it's done. And it's just one of the things you can't believe it.
The night before it happened, Peter Parkin informed me and told me what was happening. And I just couldn't believe it. I didn't know what to say to Peter. I just told Peter that I thought he was making a tremendous mistake. But he owned the hockey club and he was free to do as he chose. But I think I made my feelings quite clear to Peter on the phone. And the next day, it was called and the conference came in. They flew in from L.A. and that was it.
Daily TV programming was interrupted for news of the trade.
Good afternoon. We apologize for interrupting our regular program. We do so in order to bring you this news special. I'm Dana Lewis along with CBC's Chris Cuthbert. We take you live to Molson House where a news conference is just getting underway.
Promise Mess I wouldn't do this. But as I said, there comes a time
while the quiet Canadian town of Edmonton was in deep mourning, the city of angels was about to receive a new king.
Folks, the golden child is here. Bruce McNall announced today that Wayne Gretzky is coming to the Los Angeles Kings. The price paid for Wayne between $15 and $20 million.
Has always taken pride in buying the best.
If you buy the best in the world, no matter what it is, especially a hockey player of the caliber of Wayne Gretzky, I don't think you can go wrong.
He found out about Mr. Gretzky's character early on.
When he first came to Los Angeles, we were talking about contract, and I said, Wayne, I have no idea what to pay him. No idea. And I said, I don't either, really. So I came up with a number that I thought was fair. And Wayne said, no, that's way too much money. It's way too much money. And I said, well, seems like that would be right for you. And he said, no. And he put up another number, and I said, well, that seems a little low. And we were negotiating back and forth in reverse. And right near the end of our discussions, he said, well, if you want to pay me that much, why don't you take a certain portion of it and divide it among all my teammates as a bonus.
It's a business deal he will always remember.
It's been the single greatest decision I ever made in my life.
Wayne Gretzky had a new business address, the Great Western Forum, but the Great One had taken a great gamble too. he had left a team that was totally dominating hockey to go to the seventh worst team in the league. For the first time in ages, the Forum was sold out for hockey.
They called it the trade of the century. August 9th, 1988. The holder of 49 NHL records, number 99, Wayne Gretzky.
Kings fans found their palms moist, their pulses racing. The Great Ones show was about to begin. A goal in the first period of his first game, on his first shot. The Kings' first goal of the season. It was a script made for Hollywood. For long-suffering Kings fans, it was love at first sight. Suddenly, the silver and black were the hottest ticket in Tinseltown. Gretzky took the Kings from 3 sellouts in their previous year to 24, and the Lakers weren't the only ones having the stars come out.
He's just so good at it. There's just none better. And he's so good at it. I mean, you know, Gordie Howe was great. There were some greats. Not taking anything away from him, but, and Wayne has what they have as well. He just has that quality while he's playing and even while he's, you know, while he's out on the street.
Overnight, the Kings became the league's top road draw, and their TV audience skyrocketed.
I think Wayne Gretzky is to hockey what Dr. J and Magic Johnson are to the NBA and basketball, what Arnold Palmer was to golf. Just a fine young gentleman. I'd love to have him for a son.
We originally were doing 37 games, composed of 23 home games, 14 away games. When the suspicion, and it looked, you know, looked like the thing was going to be real for the acquisition, we jacked that up to 60 games. And this coming season, we will in fact do 78 games.
Gretzky's passes turned average players into good ones, and good players into great ones.
What he has done, he brought our team level of play so high that we've had some guys before that didn't know how good they were before Wayne came in and showed them, and he brought them up.
In January of 1989, Wayne Gretzky moved past Marcel Dion into second place on the all-time NHL scoring list. Still only 27. One man stood between him and the all-time point scoring title, the legendary Gordie Howe.
Ahead of Dion, number 2 all-time in NHL scoring.
This season also saw Wayne Gretzky appear in his 10th consecutive All-Star game. In a haunting scene, the Great One was back in Edmonton, reunited with Yari Curry one more time for old time's sake.
8 times NHL MVP, now the second leading scorer of all time. From the Los Angeles Kings, voted starting center number 99, Captain Wayne Gretzky.
Check near center by Robitaille. He got it to Gretzky, to Curry, he's in alone. Shoot, score! Curry from Wayne Gretzky, 1-0 the Campbell Conference.
You marvel at the things he's doing on the ice and how astute he is on the ice. He even knows how many seconds there's left in the penalty or there's too many people on the ice. He's always the first one to spot it. He's a very intelligent hockey player. Maybe the the most intelligent ever play the game.
There's no way in my mind that a player should beat a defenseman. The whole game is 2-on-1, in my mind. The whole game is to outman the other team, whether it be defensively or offensively. And I think that was the success of the Oilers. They always played 2-on-1. They 2-on-1'd everybody. And that's what we're doing now here.
Hockey supermind knows many secrets, including the place where goals come from.
A spot on the ice that's no man's land, and the good goal scorers find it. And it's a piece of ice that is just in between the defense and the forward. Mike Bossy used to find it all the time, and you know, Curry finds it all the time. Just the good goal scorers know where that spot is.
But when you give away 20 pounds and 2 inches, you need more than a spot. You need to reinvent the game. And Gretzky did it by setting up in an impossible place, behind the net.
Basically, I started going behind there because of my size. You know, I used to play in the power play, I'd stand in front of the net, I'd get knocked over. I started going back there to use the net as a decoy at the age of 14 or 15, so I almost made my career. If they come after you, you know, use the net as a decoy and go the other way. If they stand there, then you got either the winger or the defenseman that are open.
But it is not tricks or smoke or mirrors that make Gretzky great. It is 110% sweat, soap, nothing left on the ice hockey every night.
Wayne leads on the ice and carries it into the dressing room. You know, he's not one of the guys who stands up and yells and screams in the dressing room. But you know when he's in the dressing room, you can just feel his presence. Then when he gets on the ice, you get caught up in it. You get caught up in his attitude and his skill and his confidence, and it's a lift for everybody. You believe you can win with Wayne Gretzky on your hockey team. He burns intensity. He sits in the dressing room and dies to play. Never says anything negative to anybody, but when he's sitting there and things aren't going well, you can see it's bothering him.
Yeah, cover the middle of the ice, okay? Michael! Come on, dear.
Right back as soon as I go,
huh? Yeah, see, I go in, and then he gets by me and makes a pass, and I come out back in the middle, and you go in. The clock for the penalty's not working. Make sure they know over there, right?
His critics claim there is an unwritten law that protects him from harm on the ice. When the 1989 playoffs rolled around, the Los Angeles Kings had developed a knockout punch. Ironically, the Kings' first-round opponent was the Edmonton Oilers. The eyes of the hockey world focused on this matchup. Edmonton coach John Muckler had a new playoff problem: how to stop Wayne Gretzky.
In big games, he was really at the height of his abilities. I mean, he would pour it on. He seemed to get higher than usual, and he'd always come up big for you.
The Oilers seemed too talented and too deep for the upstart Kings. Edmonton took a commanding 3-1 series lead. Gretzky's maiden season in L.A. appeared to be over. But for Wayne Gretzky, down 3-1, is when he becomes the most dangerous.
Gretzky in front, and that goes, he scores! And now it is clear, here's Gretzky, with an empty net, Gretzky, he shoots, he scores!
Gretzky and the Kings had slain the Giant, dethroning the 4-time Cup champions. It was one of the finest performances in hockey history. The kid from Brantford had taken a 14th place team to fourth overall in 1 year. In only his 10th season, earned a record 9th Hart Trophy as the NHL's most valuable player. To LA fans, this last one may as well have been an Oscar.
I feel alive, and the crowd feels alive. I can tell it's just the intensity level is that much higher.
He strives really hard. He keeps them going. He never lets them quit.
He's also gorgeous. He has a good body. All the women like him.
After 26 Canadian winters, Wayne thawed out this offseason golfing with pro Craig Statler and friend John Candy.
Oh boy, John!
He claims he just picked it up and can hit the ball 325 yards. That impresses me. He also putts 325 yards. That didn't impress me.
What happened there? I hit that good.
Wrong way.
Well, Craig, I'm looking for my little fade. I didn't get it.
Great shot, just in the situation.
Yeah, wrong hole. Nice shot, wrong hole. Why did we hit? Come on, Kip.
Boom.
Oh! Ha ha! Well, birdie.
And now there was a new woman in his life. Daughter, Paulina.
Probably the most important thing was that he was very sensitive, very caring for other people. And he was very sensitive to my feelings and other people's feelings and loved kids and wanted that in life.
Oh, okay. Okay. There you go, Magoo.
My whole life I was brought up that no matter what you do in life, that family is very important. And I always say to people, it's an extension now. You know, I've gone from, you know, my parents and my grandparents, and now I have a wife and I have a daughter. My priority's always been my family. Materialistic things won't last. And no matter if you have $1 or $1 million, the most important thing in life is family, companionship, love.
As the 89-90 season began, Wayne Douglas Gretzky prepared for his assault on the holiest of individual records in the history of hockey. The all-time leading scorer, the legendary Gordie Howe, held a 13-point lead.
The National Hockey League's most valuable player, the Kings' newly named captain, number 99, Wayne Gretzky.
A battalion of press from around the world charted his ascent into history.
Kings come to center. Wayne Gretzky is out at center ice. He's got Lindholm over on the left wing tonight, and on the right wing is Bob Kudelski.
He came up with 3 points in the first two games. Game three was at home against the Detroit Red Wings. Had 2 more points, 5 to go. On to Vancouver.
Well, when it actually happens, it'll probably be real fluky, and by the time my daughter's old enough, it'll be an end-to-end rush. So.
Gretzky got an assist early, then helped tie the game in the third period with another assist. His flair for drama appeared again with time running out.
8 seconds ago in regulation to Robinson, now to Gretzky, right side. Gretzky drops it for Kasper, he shoots, he scores! He did it! Kasper wins the game.
Where heartbeats are skipping and hands are being wrung, enter the great one. As he had predicted, Edmonton was the likely stage for the record breaker. He needed 2 points to steal the show. He began his walk into history in the Coliseum, where he had created this appointment with destiny. Some, his presence reopened the wound of his departure. Still, they cheered the man who had given them so much.
Gets it to Duchesne. Here's Duchesne to blue line to Laidlaw. Over to Gretzky, left side. Gretzky to Laidlaw, down the middle now, in front to Nichols. He scores! Gretzky has tied Gordie Howe's record with that assist.
With his penchant for front page heroics, everyone knew what would happen next. With his team down by one, Wayne Gretzky waited until the clock ticked toward zero.
To the left side. Kings are down 4-3, trying to tie this game up. Off the draw. Here's Lowe with a minute to go in the game. Lowe cleared to the blue line, held in by Duchesne. Duchesne passed it deep to Taylor, to Gretzky. He scores! He's done it! Wayne Gretzky, the great one, has become the greatest of them all. The leading scorer in the history of the National Hockey League.
I don't come in front of the net like that. And something in my mind said, you better get out in front. And I went out there. The puck came right to me, and I didn't do a whole lot. I just threw it up and went in the top corner.
Not content with hockey's most cherished record, the great one returned that same night for an encore in overtime.
Gretzky waits there, around in front. He shoots, he scores! Wayne Gretzky wins the game for the Kings. Do you believe what you've just seen and heard?
What Mr. Hockey, Gordie Howe, had accomplished in 26 years, Wayne Gretzky had torn asunder in 10. He has averaged over 180 points per season for 10 years. An unthinkable feat, a smashing of any standard set by any player in any sport. And the grace with which he accepted these triumphs is a statement of his character.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I think it's only fitting that an award such as this takes a lot of teamwork and a lot of help. And both teams who are here today are definitely a big part of these 1,800 points that I've gotten my career. It's the greatest game in the world, and everything I have in my life. In my life, I
honor
the game of hockey. Thank you very much.
The torch was passed.
There's no end to his brilliance, and I'm just so proud of the fact that that we've gotten along so well so many years, and I'm so proud of the fact that Wayne Gretzky has called me his friend. It's one of the better things that ever happened to me in the game of hockey.
Newspapers and broadcasters heralded his greatness. And north in the heartland of Canada, the city of Edmonton created his likeness to stand there forever. glides into another firmament. Each new achievement further separating him from his fellow sportsmen. Wayne Gretzky belongs to all who have and will someday witness his gift. A gift that has lifted him above and beyond.